Deadline.
I'm going to have a couple of things.
Okay, I'll be right.
Hey, Sean. Commission Budget and Public Hearing. We'll get started with the roll call.
Okay. Mayor Brooke?
Here.
Commissioner Sarah?
Present.
Commissioner Simmons?
Here.
Vice Mayor Carter will be absent. Commissioner Vignola is presently not here. City Manager Goodrum?
Here.
Deputy City Attorney Whitaker?
Here.
Great. If everybody would please rise and join us in a moment of silence. Thank you. Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. John, how about you lead it?
I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. And Sean, you already have a shirt, so you're good to go. All right, we are already at our public comment portion of the meeting. I understand we have a couple of signed speakers.
Mayor, we do. We have three right now.
Great.
First is Marie San Ramon, Richard Malone, Ina Briscoe.
So the first one is Marie.
Is Marie here? Okay. Is Richard here? Ina, you're first.
And Nina, if you would please come up to the mic and let us know your name and your address. And welcome.
It's Ina Briscoe, and my address is 3900 Northwest 79th Avenue, 33065. So
welcome.
I am very concerned about this special assessment that you levy on my property. And last year, it was increased almost $700, or probably roughly around there. And I thought, because you went ahead and built City Hall, and when you did, I feel that I wasn't part of it, because I hear people talk about it that there wasn't any approval and you guys did what you wanted to do. And so this year, I am forced with this extra almost $900 that you force upon me, and that $900 is being assessed to the rest of people who have million-dollar houses. My house is 1,200 square feet. I do have easement on all sides, and it is in the worst part of Coral Springs. That was the first section that you built up, and so, you know, I have to carry the burden with all these other fancy places, and it's just trust upon me, and, you know, I have to accept it. So I am here to voice my grievance about that.
I understand. I appreciate you coming to us and sharing your concerns with us. We'll be having a budget presentation from Ms. Given shortly, and you'll hear comments from us after that time. Thank you. No other signed speakers, but is there someone else from the public that wishes to be heard? About anything? Up to 3 minutes? Yes, please come to the mic. And I didn't say this before, but we may not respond to exactly what your question is or concern here on the dais at this time. We might respond later today from the commission or from the city managers, so it's not meant to disrespect you. That's just part of our process. But thank you for coming.
Thank you. My name's Angela LaRussell. I'm at 2626 Northwest 98th Terrace in Coral Springs.
Welcome, Mr. Russell.
Thank you, Mayor. I've lived in Coral Springs for 3 years now, and in that 3 years, my taxes have doubled. Main perception out there is there's an awful lot of apartments being built in town, and those people are not contributing to the tax base so much as the homeowners. The homeowners, it's on the backs of all of the private homeowners. And I look at it and say, okay, well, here's another $600 or $700 I've got to pay this year, so much that year. Okay, so I say, well, I've got to cut back. So now all of a sudden, maybe I don't go to Big Bear to have that dinner that I like to have. Don't go there anymore. Don't go to get my dry cleaning done anymore. And so on and so on, not to make a long story. But the fact of the matter is, not only does it hurt me as a homeowner to have to pay additional fees, more fees, more fees, but it hurts the local business as well. Because there's lots of folks out there, I'm sure, that are doing the same thing. Well, do I take and spend that $50 for dinner, or do I gotta save it and pay it for more bills? So it seems that it's not just the homeowners that are being hurt in this whole thing. And I just don't see where it continues to come from. We got a huge increase last year. We got another one coming this year. So I'm here to listen to y'all and tell me why we should be doing this. Okay. Thank you.
You're very welcome. Thank you for being here. Would anybody else like to be heard? Okay. So at this point, public comment will be closed. Public hearings are about to follow. Our first is a budget presentation. Hi, Catherine.
Hello, thank you. And welcome to our first budget public hearing. While this is the first budget public hearing, this has been a conversation that we've been having back from April. Then we talked about it again at a workshop in June. We had some briefings, and in July, and we had briefings. So a lot of this is U-Haul have been seeing, and we've been putting information out to the public as well. Therefore, some of the slides, we have the collective decision possibly to move forward. So this is a little bit abridged. If anyone wants to go back and look at previous slides, then we do have it on our website as well from that July special meeting when we set trim. So this presentation is one presentation. There are a number of agenda topics to follow, 2 through 7, and then 9 all relate back to this presentation, so I don't have to keep coming up.
So I'm just going to ask you to go maybe just a little bit slower than you might have to make sure some of the residents that don't have the details, or this may be their first time, although it could have been their fourth or fifth time, that they have the opportunity to catch the distinctions that you're making and that we're making. Thank you.
That being said, transparency has been a budget initiative and something that we've been really trying to increase our awareness out in the community on what is in a city budget. And we have been partnering with Communications and Marketing, the outstanding Communications and Marketing, to be able to put some budget videos together. And they've all been right around 3 minutes. And this is our most recent that we have that we released. We do release it on our website. We do release it through social media, such as Facebook and Nextdoor. And with that being said, please watch the video.
Thank you.
When you hear the words city budget, you may think it's a complicated set of numbers that sound like a different language altogether. This is especially true when we talk about property taxes. To better explain revenues and expenses for the city of Coral Springs, let us explain how the property taxes you pay are distributed. The largest portion of your property taxes go to our schools. Less than one-third of the taxes you pay come to Coral Springs for city services. The third largest portion goes to Broward County. The remaining balance goes towards the Hospital District, Children's Services, the South Florida Water Management District, and Florida Inland Water Navigation District. Now that we explained how your property tax is distributed, let's break down the city's general fund revenue for the upcoming fiscal year. While the city receives 30.5% of your residential property taxes, it accounts for 46% of the revenue the city receives. 30 cents come from fees and taxes, which include electric utility service, sales, electric franchise, communication services, state municipal revenue sharing, commercial and residential solid waste franchise fees, and gas taxes. 17 cents come from service and user fees, and 7 cents come from rental fees, leases, and royalties. To better understand your tax dollars at work, let's break down how our city's general fund is budgeted for the upcoming fiscal year. Public safety has always been our top priority, and those vital services account for 50 cents of every dollar that comes into our city. 41 cents of every dollar is spent on day-to-day operations for city services, including maintenance of city roads, medians, sidewalks, and bike paths. The care of our 49 city parks, including their buildings, landscape, irrigation, equipment, and buildings. recreational programs for seniors, teens, adults, kids, and those with special needs, city vehicle maintenance, and equipment and services at City Hall in the Mall. In addition, these funds allow us to implement initiatives to improve our city, enhancing the lives of our residents. Here's a look back on what some of those initiatives. We hired additional school resource officer to ensure the safety of our children and educators. We increased our number of firefighter paramedics, developed an economic development strategic plan to bring businesses and create new jobs within our city, improved the visibility of traffic signals to lessen the risk of accidents, invest in the creation and administration of additional programs for our youth and seniors, roadway resurfacing, ongoing maintenance and protection of trees, upgraded handicap ramps at 25 intersections throughout the city. And lastly, capital improvement projects account for 9 cents of every dollar, which is used to replace playground equipment, install new energy-efficient LED lighting, and pay off debt the city has incurred. The city is committed to providing our residents with a better understanding of how property taxes and other revenue are utilized. Learn more about your city's budget and strategic plans at coralsprings.org/budget.
Thank you to Liz and the communications and marketing team. And I also wanted to recognize Ronald Gomez, who was outside with Tyler Court looking through trims with residents, but he was also a part of this. So thank you very much to be able to make that great video for us.
Well, we appreciate that.
All right, so now on to the City of Coral Springs budget overview. The 2020 proposed city budget is $253.4 million. Total number of funds are 11, and the total number of positions are 873. The total taxable assessed values continue to increase steadily but slow. And as you can see, they've now recovered from the pre-recession levels back in 2008. $10.39 billion now to $10.76 billion today. Ever since the city invested in a grant coordinator about 5 years ago, Kristen Holowicki, and continued to give additional funding dollars for contractual services, grants have typically been giving us about $1 million a year. And that is money directly coming into the city. And this year, we're very proud of the fact that we have now brought in $5 million. This has been the work of from the past couple of years leading up to this year. And we do continue to still strive to be able to increase our grant typical over $1 million funding. So what is included in that $5 million? The $1 million Bloomberg grant, the $2.8 million EDA grant for a stormwater project out in the corporate park. We have JAG money and UWASI money, that is the Department of Homeland Security, to purchase police and emergency management equipment. The Target Foundation has given us money for Shop with a Cop. The Florida Department of Education has given us funding for safety and security at our charter school, as well as the Florida Department of State with the Division of Cultural Affairs to be able to support some of the operations that the Center for the Arts that we have for them. So those are just a couple of the grants that we have been awarded this past year. But our departments have explored over $25 million worth of grants. So this effort of exploring, applying for grants is truly, that is citywide. Multiple departments, many departments go and they're researching. Budget is just the central point of contact. So I just want to give our appreciation to the other departments that have really put a lot of time and effort into that, the number there. Our vision, serving with excellence, innovation, and integrity. And our budget theme, when we looked at the strategic goals and then what was being funded through the new initiatives, are innovative projects that lead to operational efficiency, public safety enhancements for staffing and equipment, infrastructure and drainage upgrades, grant opportunities, and investing in our future. Reviewing, service levels and performance metrics are a key part of the budget process and continues throughout the year with monitoring. A quarterly report is published on our website for greater accountability and transparency for our residents and our businesses. So I do encourage people to look at some of those performance measures and service levels, which are the start of our budget process. So what this slide will show you are some of the new items that the city will be funding in the 2020 budget. So you'll see some of the turf fields, the splash pads, some of the other items. Now, for a more in-depth look of all the items that are going to be funded through the 2020 budget, I do encourage people to go look at the proposed budget book that we have posted on our website. A lot of really great hard work from all departments have been put to put this document together. This is where you can see all the projects, the descriptions, costs, as well as all the budgets. And that, so I do encourage people to go, if they want to look at that, if they want a more in-depth view, then please go into that budget book. So at this point, the 2020 business plan, the proposed highlights are as follows. Staff recommends to maintain the current millage rate of 5.8732. By doing so, the average single-family home will pay an additional $62 in property taxes by keeping the millage rate the same, and that is because their property values increased. Again, the commission is not, we are not recommending to increase the current millage rate. We're encouraging it to keep, to maintain the same.
Catherine, I'm going to interrupt you for a moment because at least one of the residents indicated last year she had an increase of 700. This year she's got an increase of 900, and her house is 1,200 square feet. So can you explain a little bit about that number? How do you get to the $62?
I can probably explain both. I don't know her certain circumstance without looking at her tax bill. My first thought is, have you been in the house for a full year? A lot of times when people move into the city at that point, you aren't homesteaded. And if the previous homeowner was homesteaded, and at that point, then you are now paying a new price. And at that point, it can cause that much of a shift in that first year. But I do encourage anyone who, if this is your home, please get yourself homesteaded. This is based off of an average single family home of, I'll be getting there in a minute, but I don't mind talking about it right now.
You can get there in a minute, no problem.
Well, it's fine. It's the average market value is $376,000, and the average assessed value on that same home is $281,000.
Gotcha. So for the average home, the additional taxes, keeping the millage rate the same, is $62.
Just for the ad valorem. We'll get to the what the total is for the non-ad valorems in a little bit.
Gotcha. Thank you.
Next is the voter-approved debt service will decrease. Then we move down to the fire assessment rates. Single-family, multifamily, commercial, industrial, and institutional. Residential solid waste assessment will increase by $30. Stormwater assessment will be set at $115.66 per ERU, and water rates will increase by $2.40 per month based off the 3.5% water and wastewater rate study. So let's move into those non-ad valorems. It's a good time.
Okay.
The fire assessment comparison. This slide shows the local cities with full-service fire departments. You can see what the history has been since 2018, 19, and what other fire departments as well as our own are proposing. I will say this year is a little bit unique in the fact that every 3 to 5 years, the fire and budget department partner to look with an outside company to review all calls, line items, staffing, projections, and we call that a fire assessment study. This is the result. The result of this study was what we thought we were going to have to pay. GSG is the consultant that we used, came within cents of what we thought we were, the rate should be. So typically this is maybe $5, $10, $20 off. We were really on track with what the consultant had recommended. So this is in line with that study as well. So I, being that that was a large effort, thanks to the chief and his staff, Sharon, the data analyst, as well as Tyler and my staff. So this is the fire assessment comparison. So what's in the rates? I understand people are wanting to know, well, what am I getting for that? You can see the single family, multifamily, commercial, industrial, warehouse, and institutional rates. In that, we are adding three firefighter paramedic. We're continuing the focus on firefighter safety and health. And some of the capital requests are the debt service we're replacing for Station 64 and debt service going toward the Fire Academy expansion. We have supplies and equipment for them, such as the rapid intervention team bags, pickup trucks that will go toward the initiative of the Clean Cab Initiative, as well as facilities replacement plan, and we're adding a left turn lane in for Park Summit. In addition, we are really concentrating on the reserves, and we'll talk a little bit about the financial policies at the end of the presentation, but one thing that we are trying to do is set up the fire fund appropriately to their fund level reserve. Moving on to the residential solid waste comparison. This, each city has a varying level of service. Some cities have, like Coral Springs has bulk pickup every week. Some cities do it once a month. Other cities do it every 2 weeks. Some cities have bags. Some cities have containers. So it's very difficult to kind of look at where we are on this. However, I understand that people do like to see what other cities are paying for their solid waste. Let's go into a little bit of why the increase in solid waste. The collection costs have gone up. Disposal costs have gone up. Recycling costs have gone up. And that is just a part of our service with Waste Pro. I will also say that the contingency line has gone up as well. Solid waste has a minimal fund balance under $50,000, so this is something that we know we need to be dedicating money toward. And we also know in time that when we go back out for an RFP, this is something that we're seeing other cities are, their rates are much higher, so we're just needing to have that placeholder for us for right now. That is solid waste. The water and sewer fund highlights. We are talking about just the area in the pink. We provide service to approximately 65,000 residents. And as I said, with the water and sewer fund, we recommend the 3.5% weighted average rate, and this is due to a water and wastewater rate study. In 2019, the city created the Horticultural Division in Public Works. This was an area that we knew that we took direction from the commission saying we would need more in landscape improvements and that, so we created the division, set aside operating funds for it. This has been the first year we've had that, and we're able to pull in tree trust fund money to be able to add more, more funding to go toward that. All right, so the new staff for the 2020. As I mentioned before, with the fire fund, the firefighter paramedic, the three adds to staff, it is split between fire fund and general fund. We're adding a civil engineer that is out of the water and sewer fund, and the community involved liaison is out of the police department. So you'll see this is the full-time number of employees, and you'll see at the top we do have contractual employees, and we do have the other full-time employees. You'll see between 19 and 20, the count goes up by three, but on the previous slide, I just showed you there are five adds to staff. And that is because that we, through attrition, two of the parks, the maintenance workers, will be eliminated due to the operations of the turf fields. So at this point, now we only have to go up three adds to staff. And this is our general fund five-year forecast. This is something that we stayed very disciplined to, and we're very proud of. It's a financially sustainable, positive five-year forecast. As you can see by that bottom line, always look to the bottom line, right? It's a conservative view. We only know what we know today. So we know that there could be unfunded mandates. That's not accounted for. There could be the need to be able to add on SROs, depending on a law or a recommendation or a decision there. Tariffs on goods, the cost of construction, grass, copper, things like that can increase this in future years, and that's not necessarily accounted for, other than we can say in ad valorem, how much do we think property values will go up? Right now, this past year, it was right around 4.6%. We keep it just overall at 4%. It can go higher or lower, and that's kind of middle-of-the-road conservative path. This model, before I turn it over to Stan Tech to kind of walk through what the city has been doing with keeping a positive five-year forecast, we aren't mentioning Hurricane Irma's reimbursement. So that is something we know will be happening. We talk about it. We've talked a little bit about it with financial policies and where will that money go. However, this five-year forecast does not include the $8.2 million still outstanding from FEMA on Hurricane Irma. That is the debris cost and emergency protective measures. We've received about $800,000 from Hurricane Irma to date. But this is our five-year forecast. Without Further ado, you have seen Eric Von Melsom with StanTech before, and I give the floor to him.
Thank you, Catherine. Good evening, members of the commission, Catherine. Members of the city. My name is Eric Van Malsen. I'm a principal consultant with StanTech Financial Services. What we do is we perform cash flow analyses and financial projections for municipalities, and our focus is cities and counties within the state of Florida. We've worked with the city of Coral Springs for a couple of years now, and when we first started this analysis, working with staff, we identified a real structural issue with the cash flows of the city's general fund. Repeatedly, the fund was spending more money than it was bringing in while trying to maintain and enhance its level of services to meet the goals of the city. It had gotten by through some one-time cash windfalls from property sales and some stopgap measures. But we realized when we started this analysis last year that there had to be a structural shift. This commission did a lot of work and asked sacrifices of both the rate and taxpayers and also their employee groups to restrict costs and limit the growth of those costs to match the revenues that you know will be coming in going into the future. We worked through an overall plan that had several measures on the, both the income and expense side to create a sustainable financial forecast. What you're looking at on the screen is our control panel of our model, and if you just focus on the bottom two graphs, that's where the real answer is. The bottom left graph shows year over year what the projected reserve balances of the general fund would be under two different scenarios. Those green bars show those reserve balances depleting to near zero by fiscal year 21 and to zero by fiscal year 22, where that black line near the top of the graph represents the minimum required target that this city has adopted to keep in the bank for the general fund for not only liquidity reasons, but also for emergency reasons and emergency repairs, such as using those funds for hurricanes like Irma. That green scenario is essentially where we started last year, and through all the hard work of this commission, staff, and management in restricting cost growth and enhancing and diversifying revenues, we now get to the blue bars, and that's where we are now, with a fantastic, sustainable-looking future that tracks your minimum reserve targets, maintains it, and over time creates a sustainable future where cash coming into this fund relatively equals cash going out to the fund and every year the forecast. Now, this is contingent on a few things that have yet to be solidified, one of them being the stormwater utility fee, which will provide a direct funding source for the operations, maintenance, and capital funding of your stormwater utility program. This will provide the general fund with some cash flow support to create the sustainable future. Without that stormwater fee, and I'm going to turn that fee off, and the cash flow impacts would greatly affect the general fund, ultimately depleting reserves once more starting next year, and that correction would not correct itself without compounding revenues over a 5+ year period, and it would take a significant action to revive those reserves back to that minimum target. So when we put together a 5-year program last year, this was one of the parts of the solution that has yet to be adopted and is before you tonight in the next few readings. Going forward, this city looks to have a sustainable forecast for its general fund, which is more often than not a rare thing in this state. Many, many cities and counties are struggling with cash flow deficits to fund ongoing costs while trying to build a level of service that they are proud of. This city has achieved that part of it, and to maintain the level of service going forward and cash flow sustainability, it's still going to require some work, but a lot of the hard work is done so far, and we're proud to say that we've been tracking this for a couple years now, and you're on a good path. I'd be happy to run any scenarios and answer any questions about our analysis and the data behind this before I step down from the podium. So if the commission has any questions for me or wish to run any scenarios, you've seen how the model works and how I can manipulate it on the fly, let me know.
Questions? Okay, we're good. Thank you, Eric.
So what is our operating millage? Where do we stand with other cities? These are some like cities, as well as we did put Fort Lauderdale, which we're not like, and Hollywood, which we're not like, but at the same time, they're cities that typically people ask about. So if you're wanting to look at where we stand with all 31 municipalities in Broward, then you'll see we're kind of in the middle low, middle of the low side. 13 from the bottom. The most common question or roundabout question that we answer in my office, and we've gotten probably in this tax cycle since the tax since the TRIM have gone out, we've probably gotten about 20 questions. And truly, a lot of the questions are, you know, you're only paying 30% to Coral Springs. How much of your tax bill goes to the city? 30%.
And what page is this, if you have that handy? Well, okay, I'll find it.
And that was the first bout of information that we really wanted to put out on the video. So same slide, same information, but only 30% of your tax bill is going to the city of Coral Springs. If you pick up that house and you put it in, let's say, the city of Miramar, you'll be paying $396 in Miramar. Or if you pick up your house and just put it in Papineau Beach, you'll be paying $67 less. So that is what this slide depicts. Business plan highlight, the staff recommends, as I said, to propose the same millage rate. State law requires that 4-1 vote to keep the millage rate exactly the same. This is advertised as a tax increase, even though that you are saying we would recommend to keep the millage rate the same. And this is the slide that we were getting to, the impact of this average single-family home. As we talked about the ad valorem, the increase per year is $62. Let's talk about some of the other assessments. The voted debt, as I said, was going to slightly decrease. You can see that. And the fire assessment did increase for the average single-family home. Stormwater assessment was set. And the solid waste assessment went up $30. So what the impact is $235 for the typical average home value as listed above. And what that means is a little less than $20 per month. Okay. And we're right at the very end of the presentation, and I did want to talk about financial policies. Why is it important to have these? Could be a question that people have, and I'm not going to go through reading the entire slide, but what are financial policies? They provide the guidelines for the city's overall fiscal management and planning for the adequate funding of city services. Some policy statements are driven by state requirements or city charter, while others are formally documented through policies and procedures, and that's what we did. The commission directed staff to review the financial policies during strategic planning about a year ago. So it's been about a year for myself and truly Kim Moskowitz, who is the department director of finance. She was hand in hand with me on this. So while I'm up here presenting, she would be exactly hand in hand with me, as well as Laura Norwalk and her team and my team. We have Marissa Vanellis and Lori working on it. So we really partnered up. We looked at what we had in existence. We always have had financial policies, but we only had the commission vote and adopt the fund balance requirement. At this point now, it really gave us a good opportunity to look at those older financial policies. And now we have a pretty thick version of the new financial policies and what is in them. So the previous resolution, as I said, was a statement of fund balance, and we recommend adopting all of our financial policies. It's a document description of a lot of our existing practices. Again, it's just putting a pen to paper what we do and put it out there for all to see. We've updated the layout so that when you look at the table of contents, you can go strictly to say, you know, how does a city manage their debt? We'll talk about that. How do they deal with reserves? We have that. How do they deal with surplus? And so they can go to the different sections, and it's a more configured for a logical development. We've modernized the content because now we have stormwater, proposing stormwater, and we have a parks replacement. So we are adding that language in there. We've incorporated stronger if-then statements in this. So if there's a surplus, then it goes to. So at that point, it makes us more disciplined. So let's talk about that. Some of the additions and the changes that we've made is we previously had a 17% stabilization fund requirement. We've heard from the commission as well as the city manager, you know, it's really a good idea to increase that. We know with hurricanes and other types of things that can happen that it makes sense for a community like ours to have larger than that 17% stabilization fund in reserve when you need it. So now, or previously it said 17%, now we're saying it's good to adopt a range of 17 to 25%. We are not saying to do it in which year because a lot of what we believe how we're going to get there is through the IRMA reimbursement, and we have no control on when that's coming in. So the range will keep us disciplined in how to get the different levels there, or the additional funding there. The other piece to the financial policies is an operational increase to make sure that we are structurally balanced in our general fund. So if we have an if-then statement to where if we have talked about that 3% number that Eric previously said and we've been talking about, if the city chooses to keep the same service level and the revenues are not coming in at that 3% rate, then at that point it will make us look to having a millage increase. That is what is in these financial policies. Again, it was a lot of effort between two different departments and clearly the city manager's office. And at this point, I'd be remiss to say that clearly a budget document is the work of every department and their staff. So I have to say thank you so much to the department directors behind me, to my staff sitting over there. It's a lot of work putting this all together. It's a great teamwork. With you all, it's been a lot of conversation. So with that, this is our FY 2020 annual budget. Any questions?
I have a question, Mr. Mayor.
I don't have any. Commissioner Simmons.
So with the financial policy, I had previously mentioned, and I want to bring it to my colleagues, saying that it, you know, if that's a document that we're putting out there for the community, that we add a bit of a glossary, not super exhaustive, mm-hmm. but some sort of financial or glossary defining some of the, you know, major terms that are used throughout the document, so that if anyone does, you know, want to go on one day and say, hey, I want the financial policy of Coral Springs, that, you know, any layperson will be able to understand what is in that document. So
that makes sense. You guys okay with that?
You'll be voting on that, Mayor and Commissioner. I'm number 9, so anyone could make that part of a motion to include the glossary.
Okay.
Yes.
Great. And number 9. Great.
Okay with that?
Sure. We already have a glossary ready. We put it in the budget book, so I don't mind putting it right here.
Great. Thank you. Any further questions of Catherine?
I have a question, Catherine. Residents that are watching and are in the audience, stormwater assessment. My understanding, based on the briefings and what I've reviewed, this is the very first time that the residents of Coral Springs have ever seen this assessment, right?
Yes, sir.
And on average, it's about $115. Is that an average or is that a set?
It's set by ERU.
Okay. So can you give a little bit of a historical perspective? My understanding is this has been talked about for years. There are other counties that have already enacted the stormwater assessment, and like where our assessment maybe falls compared to other counties or
sure.
other cities within Broward County.
Sure. Before my time, what I've been told is the city started looking at stormwater back in the early 2000s, and it was really brought back in 2007 as let's start doing some studies on this. Unfortunately, the downturn happened in 2009, and at that point, you know, it's a hard thing when the downturn happens to then start an assessment. So at the time, that did not move forward. However, our infrastructure has been continuously declining, decaying, and at this point, we know that it's needed. When we look at some of our communities in Westchester, Corporate Park, Meadows, and Dells, and we know there are other areas as well that we haven't even had a chance to research to do a master plan on, that this is something that our community does need. The fact that we have our own, we're proposing it as our own fund, then all work and all funding coming into that will only be dedicated to the work of stormwater. As it exists today, it's in the general fund, and you know it has to compete with general fund dollars, with public safety, with our parks and infrastructure. You know, so at this point, by having its own fund, its own dedicated source, has been our recommendation. With that, we've been working, as I said, with EDA, with to be able to receive a grant. Part of that grant was the fact that we were looking at putting money to aside in its own fund. So we will continue to go out and try to reach more grant dollars so that we can keep that assessment as low as we can. In terms of, I think, other 17 other communities in Broward do have a stormwater assessment. So this is not something that we were first, second, third on. This has been in existence for a lot of other municipalities in Broward and across the state. I know that Eric's nodding his head. as well as rating agencies, if you don't mind me saying. One of the other pieces were when we talked to rating agencies that they have even seen that the communities have stormwater, and their question to us is, why don't you have stormwater? It's one of the options available to you. We were trying to make it work in other ways, but we really saw the need for capital to invest into what can actually help the infrastructure of the city. Go ahead.
This area of the state has been quite on the forefront of using special assessments to have a dedicated funding source for these types of services. To the extent that the state allows a dedicated funding source, it's often very beneficial of the city to take advantage of it, such as a fire assessment. Many cities would love to fund their police department through a special assessment, but the assessment has to benefit property and not people, so that's kind of one of those disconnects. A stormwater utility fee is a very common one, particularly in this area of the state, and as a financial consultant, we would always recommend taking advantage of that, particularly for the reason of revenue diversification. It gives you a dedicated funding source that's not going to fluctuate with the whims of the economy. If your properties start to decline in value, such as we saw a decade plus ago, your funding source is still going to be there because it's not based upon taxable value that the market can wipe away. So the extent that you are not relying upon those ad valorem revenues to fund everything is going to not only give you a better credit rating and ability to fund the city's infrastructure going forward, but just isolates you from risk. It's just like in our personal finances, you don't want to have all your eggs in one basket, and this is one of the great mechanisms of doing so.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Excellent job. Thank you. So next is Resolution 2019-043. This is fiscal year 2019-2020 non-ad valorem special assessment for fire services.
Thank you, Mayor. This is a resolution of the City of Coral Springs, Florida, relating to the provision of fire services, facilities, and programs in the City of Coral Springs, Florida, approving the assessment rate for fire services, imposing a fire services assessment against assessed property located within the City of Coral Springs for the fiscal year beginning on October 1st, 2019, approving the assessment rule, providing for severability, providing for conflicts, and providing for an effective date. And Mayor, this is a request to hold a public hearing and adopt.
Okay, is there anyone from the public that wishes to be heard on this item? Okay, seeing none, the public hearing is closed. Move to approve?
Second.
Second. Any discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Carries unanimously. Next item is item number 3, Resolution 2019-044, calendar year 2020 non-ad valorem special assessment for solid waste residential services.
Resolution 2019-044, a resolution of the City of Coral Springs, Florida, relating to the provision of solid waste collection services in the City of Coral Springs, Florida, approving the assessment rate for solid waste collection services, imposing a solid waste collection assessment against assessed property located within the City of Coral Springs for the calendar year beginning on January 1st, 2020, approving the assessment rule, providing for severability, providing for conflicts, and providing for an effective date. And this is a request to hold a public hearing and adopt.
Is there anyone from the public that wishes to be heard on this item? Okay, seeing none, public hearing is closed.
Move to approve.
Moved and seconded. Any discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Carries unanimously. Thank you. Next item is item number 4, Resolution 2019-042, fiscal year 2019-2020 non-ad valorem special assessment for stormwater collection.
It's a resolution of the City of Coral Springs, Florida, relating to the provision of Coral Springs stormwater collection assessment, providing the assessment rate for the collection assessment, imposing a stormwater collection assessment on property located within the City of Coral Springs for the fiscal year beginning on October 1st, 2019, approving the assessment rule, providing for severability, providing for conflicts, and providing for an effective date. And this is a request to hold a public hearing and adopt.
This is a public hearing. Anybody from the public wish to be heard on this item? Yes. Welcome, and please give us your name and your address.
My name is Rick Huggins. I live at 2920 Northwest 107th Avenue.
Sounds to me like you guys are slam dunking all these tax increases. I don't hear a word or anything about it. Am I incorrect?
That you're not hearing a word about it?
I don't hear you guys talk about it or anything, but the lady gives a proposal and all you guys do are saying yes, and that means I'm going to be paying more. Is that correct?
Yeah, I'll give you a full 3 minutes and I will give you a quick response.
A quick response. I'm curious.
So if you look back at our budget calendar, we actually begin discussions all the way back in October. So there's a lot of review that we've had of a proposed budget, a lot of discussions both this commission and the prior commission had leading us here. So a lot of times when you're here, as you are now, we've actually been through a thorough review and asked many, many questions on many occasions. So, and we've actually had the trim hearing that occurred in July, and we asked many questions then. We get briefed individually. We've met with Catherine on several occasions, and we hear from a lot of residents through a lot of different avenues.
And those meetings are
public as well. So for my information then, I haven't been able to attend all your meetings. Could you tell me why you're increasing all these things, just in a few words, in less than 3 minutes?
We will share more openly at the time of the millage rate. I'm happy to share at that time. If any of my colleagues would like to share now, they're welcome to.
That's what I came here for. I thought you guys were going to tell us why or why not you were going to do something.
This is your time, and so you didn't let us get to the discussion part, and maybe that would help alleviate some of your concerns when we talk about this. The solid waste and fire assessments, those are pretty standard. As far as the rate that they're being increased, but as far as the stormwater, which two members of the public have already spoken about, that was something that I'm pretty sure that, I know I was going to address once we got to the discussion part. So this is your time, and I'm taking your time. So I don't know if you have anything else you would like to say.
Take my time and tell me your opinion before
I leave.
And I
plan to address it during the discussion portion of the meeting as well. But I do invite you to become part of the Citizens Government Academy. There are a lot of details that are shared in the academy, and there'll be an exhaustive presentation of the budget and how you can get involved in the budget more so than at a three-minute portion of the meeting today.
I've been a homeowner here for 40 years. I've been to probably a half a dozen of these meetings in my lifetime. I've never seen anybody vote against a tax increase. I was hoping today I might see something different. I'm disappointed that I'm seeing you guys slam dunk all these increases. I'm disappointed.
I believe it was
part of my 3 minutes. Thank you very much.
I believe it was the fiscal year 2012 that the commission discussed at length a tax increase and voted it down. I was a part of that commission. I just think that, you know, we had meetings as a commission dating back to December. Gentleman's leaving, but just for everyone else, we've had meetings going back to December on these issues, and we've been working through this process. And I think that's maybe why people might think we're not asking a lot of questions, but I think, you know, when you look at everything, totality of it, all these things were prepped because of our ideas and the visions that we had for the city. So,
for those of you that may be watching at home, and those of you that are here, this is something that we have reviewed at length. And to be frank with you, one of the best times to really be heard about your concerns and maybe your ideas about potential cuts, because we asked ourselves and we asked staff, where do we make cuts? You know, where might we make cuts given the level of demand for services in our community? And it's not an easy thing for us to say even keep the millage rate the same. I think several of us, you know, if not all of us, would love to be able to actually lower taxes. And then the question is, we lower it, if we lower the millage rate, if we roll that back, what do we lose? And what is the expense of that loss? So I think that we happen to be very proactive. I think my colleagues, you know, including Commissioner Vignola, before I just got back here this past March, are forward thinking. I think our city manager is very proactive. I think our budget director and her team have done a lot of work, and of course, we get input from all the departments, and we welcome input from all the citizens throughout the year. Not necessarily every commission. Can you meet with the commissioners, you know, with set office hours or unset office hours? And all five of us are available. I'm available tomorrow, 8 to 9:30. I'll stick around another half hour. You can meet with me. I'll be at New York Bagel Factory, and you can ask me any questions you have, share any commentary that you have at that juncture. I do welcome input. We welcome input all the time. The process of this hearing is that we hear the public for the public portion of the meeting, and then we'll actually entertain a motion, and then we'll have discussion. So I anticipate that you'll have discussion on this item once there's a motion. There is still a public hearing. You are welcome to come to the podium. And again, please give us your name and your address.
Briscoe, 3900 Northwest 79th Avenue, 33065. I'm curious to see, what is this Sunshine Double CD for? I understand it's not associated to Coral Springs. It's on the tax proposal.
Sunshine.
Sunshine, abbreviation, double CD.
The Water Control District. Sunshine Water Control District. It's a drainage district. In fact, one of the board members is over there. It's not a part of the city. It's a Sunshine Water Control District. They handle drainage in the canals, basically.
Yeah, well, it's charged me $255 for that, and it's not even on me, and it's not even part of the city.
When the rains come, goes into the storm drains, when it hits the canals, that district goes ahead and takes care of it. There's actually a board member from the Sunshine Water Control District back there. I'm sure he'll be able to discuss you what they do and why their rates are what they are.
It seems to me that, you know, you have so much bills here and associated to the assessment, the storm drain or whatever, and, you know, like I told you before, it adds up to me $900. I'm a retired person, and I live in a small little place, and to tuck on this extra, it's, you know, it's a burden for me, all of this adding up together.
We understand what you're sharing with us, and we appreciate your sentiments. I would urge you to speak with our budget person outside so that person can explain to you other items beyond the item that we're here today, which is the millage rate and the stormwater rate and the sewage rate.
And all of that, and all she's going to say, you know, like, this is what it is. I'm one person, and, you know.
Understand. Thank you. This is still a public hearing. Would anybody from the public wish to be heard? All right, seeing none, the public, you'd like to come on up? If you'd be kind enough to let us know your name and
my name is Gus Lillevoie. I live at 11,000 Lake Drive.
Welcome.
I've been there for 19 years. I don't mind you increase the budget, you increase the waste removal by $30 for the year. But at least I would like to get the service that I'm paying for. Okay? My pickup day are Tuesdays and Fridays. Why is my garbage not picked up by Wednesday afternoon? This is something that's been going on for a very, very long time. All right? And I think maybe you guys have to address that. Whether Mr. Bergeron doesn't want to spend more money to get more trucks, that's his problem. But at least I would like to have my garbage picked up on time. Number two, we do pay a company to cut the grass in the median, at least on Lakeview Drive that I know of. That's a peaceful job. One day they cut one side, they don't cut the other side. You know, it's just like they're doing the job, but they don't care what they're doing. The city has to look at those type of things because we pay for the service. And maybe I'm picky, but I've always been picky. That's been my type of a job to do as an auditor.
It's okay to be picky.
The idea is, I pay for it, give me the service that I asked for. That's all I have to say, okay?
You can, Joshua.
What I will say, sir, too, is please don't let a problem that you see in the city linger for too long. Email us.
Well, The thing is this, you have 800 employees. Somebody has to look at what we're paying for. I understand what you're saying. I will not be the only one sending you an email, but if I'm paying for it, have somebody in the city do that. Do you know that for 2 years, right on Lakeview Drive, there's a small canal right there? Right down there, I don't know who's responsible for it. Is it the people on the other side of the street or what? You have palm phone that has been there for more than a year. It has never been cleaned the last 2 or 3 years.
I think you have a great opportunity to be in touch with us through different avenues. And I give our employees every which way, including code enforcement, a lot of credit for covering a lot of ground and a lot of people. In part, we do rely on you and other citizens for your input to share with us as you are tonight.
I understand your point, okay, but I had to bring it up because, you know, hey, it's been there for years. Nobody does anything about it. So tonight, I'm bringing it up tonight.
Okay. I appreciate you bringing it up. Other people have had trouble with their garbage pickups as well.
I know
and
that.
We are working on it.
Okay.
We are working on it.
I just would like to say in just a short period of time that I've been on the commission because I just recently got, I'm sorry. I just wanted to say in the short period of time that I've been on the commission, okay, and part of the reason why I ran to be a city commissioner is to address the type of concerns that you're saying, okay? But you do have to reach out to us because I, in just 3 months, have noticed that when we bring things to the staff's attention, if it can be corrected, it is corrected, and it's corrected in a timely manner. But you have to advocate for yourself first and then others beyond that.
I'm talking for the whole street because I'm the only one here, okay, from the street, all right? There was a big difference between Atlantic and Coral Ridge Drive.
Right.
Okay? Because you have Homeowner Association, okay, and Eagle Creek and all that. From that point on to Coral Spring Drive, no association. So, you know, nobody is looking out for it.
Okay. But what I wanted to kind of reinforce is that you have a voice and that's why we're here. We're here to serve you. We're not here to serve ourselves. But also, like, none of us, and I don't want to steal any of Commissioner Simmons' thunder here, but every meeting I've been a part of, none of us on this dais want to raise taxes because we're all paying this as well. The idea is being fiscally responsible and having a vision for the future. We can't really do anything about the decisions that were made last year or 5 years ago. We can only make the very best decisions we can moving forward. So
it's a matter of taking a good care of it. The same way that we pay, we don't have a problem, but give us the service that we want.
Correct. Yeah.
Thank you. Anybody else? Please. So just as this young lady's coming up, you know, for those of you that are citizens here in Coral Springs, we answer to you. We must answer to you. And any of our organizational charts, you are at the top, not us. So we're happy that you're here, and we're happy to receive your input and hear from you.
Thank you. Hi, my name is Meg Lordesina. I live at 8837 Northwest 20th Manor in Coral Springs. I'm here 20 years.
Welcome.
Thank you. I know last year we were assessed for the canal erosion, the embankments, we were assessed for that. And I know I'm on the list because I'm falling into the canal, literally. Mm. And I was just wondering, it's been almost a year, and they were projecting maybe October it would be starting the project. I don't know the status. I haven't seen anything. So I just wanted an update on the canal issues, the eroding.
Is there someone that can give her an update?
Yeah, what we'll do is whenever you're ready to leave, we have staff here that will know that answer. They'll meet you and be able to address that for you.
Great. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Would anybody else like to be heard? Okay. Seeing none, the public hearing is closed. May I hear a motion?
Move to approve.
Move to approve and second. Discussion. Commissioner Simmons?
All right. So, at this time last year, I was campaigning. I was not at the dais, and I was at the meeting where we had to raise the millage rate 1.15 mils. And before I continue, I want to give my kudos to Catherine Givens because I've seen her take many, many, many arrows from a lot of different directions by just presenting what is best for the city. And being on this side of the dais and having to ask those questions and being able to ask those questions and really see the numbers and really see our departments and really see where our money is going and how it's being allocated, I've gained a better understanding of the tough decisions that are in fact being made. I tried to meet as many people as I could while I was campaigning, and the thing that was always asked was, are you going to lower our taxes? And I would always reply, if I said yes, I would be lying to you. Is that what you want me to do? Do you want me to lie to you? What I will say is that, and what I always said to them was, what I will do is try to make sure that we have better long-term planning so that we won't have to go after such large increases anymore. The stormwater assessment fee was presented to us my first commission meeting. I'll never forget it. At least funding the putting the mechanism for funding in place. And I voted to approve that funding mechanism. And I did that because I realized that through my campaigning and my studying and really going into the weeds and all of this, because it wasn't just important for me to win, it was important for me to be good at this job and do what I'm supposed to do for the people of Coral Springs. And understanding that, you know what? Tough decisions were not made in the past. They were not. They were presented, they were not made. And unfortunately, as a city, we have to do that. Still. We're coming out, we're getting from under the dark clouds, we're getting better, it's getting a little sunny and bright, but we still have to make some tough decisions, and this is another one of those. If I upset you or anger you because I approve this stormwater assessment, I sincerely apologize, but it is in the best interest of the city. I'm 31 years old, I'm a public school teacher. Mind you, we are 45th in the nation in pay, and I recently became a homeowner. And I am watching these numbers and watching money fly out of my pockets too. I get it. I really do get it. But what does it mean to live in a city? I get that we have our little homes and that those are our castles, our property, our island. But what about next door? Right, that's our neighbor. People down the street, that's our neighbor. People that live on the opposite end of the city, that's our neighbor. We all live in the city together, and unfortunately, we have to kind of pick up together and do those hard things to push the city forward so that in the future, we won't have to make such critical decisions. I'm sorry that this is being seen as it is an increase, but every year everything gets expensive. My pay doesn't go up, but everything else gets expensive. This is the right thing to do, y'all. We have asked our questions. This is the rookie. Look at the rookie.
My apologies. Somebody was calling in.
There you go. But we really have asked a lot of questions, a ton of questions, lots of back and forth. This is our fourth time, maybe fifth or sixth if you've been reviewing it, seeing all of this information. That's why we aren't so vocal about it. But I understand. I really do understand. We live here too. We love this city. You can't run for office here if you don't live here. But this is the right decision for the city. So,
thank you for your comments, Commissioner. I really appreciate it. Anybody else? Yeah. So in regards to the stormwater assessment, it is proactive. It is very common. I do agree with Commissioner Simmons. It's the right thing to do. We want to preserve our property. We want to help our homeowners, and we think it's a reasonable fee to charge. So I am going to be approving this when it comes to the vote. Any further discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? All right, carries unanimously. And we really do appreciate the input from the public. We are entitled to you're entitled to have answers to your questions. You're entitled to your opinions. And you're also entitled to have us serve you to the best way we can. And that is our goal and our intention. Next item is item number 5, resolution 2019-046, fiscal year 2019-2020, nuisance abatement assessment.
Thank you, Mayor. This is a resolution of the City of Coral Springs, Florida, relating to the provision of Coral Springs assessment of cost incurred by the city to correct public health, safety, and welfare violations, approving the assessment rate, imposing an assessment on certain real property which has been specially benefited by the city's abatement of public health, safety, and welfare violations thereon, approving the assessment role, providing for severability, providing for conflicts, and providing for an effective date. And this is a request to hold a public hearing and adopt.
Anyone here from the public that wishes to be heard on this item, item number 5? Okay, seeing none, the public hearing is closed. Does anybody need any questions answered? No?
Second.
Okay, it's moved and seconded by Commissioner Simmons. Any discussion? All in favor, please say aye. Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Carries unanimously. Next is item number 6, resolution 2019-045, tentative millage rate.
This is a resolution of the City Commission of the City of Coral Springs establishing a tentative millage rate of 5.8732 to balance the general fund for fiscal year 2019-2020, which is 0.2728 or 4.87% more than the rollback rate, establishing a tentative general obligation debt millage rate of 0.2534, establishing the rollback rate to be 5.6004, and establishing Wednesday, September 18th, 2019, as the date that a final public hearing will be held at 6:30 p.m. at the City of Coral Springs City Hall, 9500 West Sample Road, providing for an effective date. And this is a request to hold a public hearing and adopt.
Is there a motion?
Yeah, public hearing.
Oh, I'm so sorry. It is a public hearing. Is there anyone from the public that wishes to be heard on this item regarding the millage rate? Yes, please come on up and let us know your name and address.
Hi, this is Carlos Perez, 11 Southwest, 112th Terrace.
Welcome.
In regards to the millage rate, and let me start my timer. In regards to the millage rate, if we look at the forecasted five-year budget plan, while I'm not necessarily opposed to the millage rate holding, that budget plan actually indicates at least the tentative nature to increase that millage rate over the next 5 years, 1.2%.
Thank you.
Or mils, is that your unit? Unit, all right. But it also assumes that property values will also be increasing. And therefore, I have a timer. I was wanting to ask the analyst whether or not, well, two main questions. The first being that his charts and his numbers never actually accounted for the financial status of Coral Springs before 2019 in order to show a change. It only shows a positive change from 2019 in the next 5 years, but that's also assuming two millage increases over the next 5 years. So, where am I going with this? I am.
Okay.
Main question being that there are plenty of other expenses that we all end up having to incur. Some of them are based on our property values, others are not. But when does the cost of living, after 5 years, when we have, and I'm not sure that 1,253,000 is 17 to 25% buffer, when does that stabilize, is my question. Because things are going to get more expensive, as Mr. Simmons suggested. We all know that, but that's not always guaranteed for some things in life.
If it's okay with the city manager, I would have Catherine address your question at an appropriate time for her department, and potentially with Eric from Stantec. That's okay.
Yeah, we'll reach out, but I can also, when we get into this item, I have a few
sure.
comments for the
okay.
commission.
Okay, sounds good, Mike. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you for your questions. Is there anyone else from the public that wishes to be heard? Okay, seeing none, the public hearing is closed. It's been moved to approve. Seconded by Commissioner Simmons. Any discussion? Yes, Commissioner Vignola.
I understand your concerns looking at the increases that are already scheduled over the next few years. First off, I won't be on the commission in the next few years, but I'm hoping that they stick to this plan because when I got elected and looking at some of the things in Coral Springs, you know, we had the recession that affected everybody, but it affected the city. I grew up here, so I went to kindergarten at Coral Springs Elementary and spent almost my whole life here. And the thing for me was when we did the large tax increase a few years ago, I think a lot of people said, hey, you know, Coral Springs, you know, had a good run. You know, they weren't doing the things necessary to stay the way that Coral Springs' reputation was. And the commission made a very, very tough decision to go ahead and raise taxes and raise it a lot. But I think our residents have a higher expectation, a higher level of service required. And when you take a look at the different departments and what you get here for your dollar, it's honestly second to none. When you go ahead and you look at things like, you know, when we made the decision, I guess none of you guys, that's kind of weird, I'm the old guy. we made the decision years ago to go ahead and keep our own dispatch center. And a lot of people went ahead and went to the county. And it cost us a lot more money. And we got bashed. It's nothing like, you know, going ahead and looking to Sun Sentinel and seeing your name with making a bad decision. And now looking back 5 years later, everyone says, man, you know, you guys made the right decision. There's a lot of things that you pay a little bit more for here in Coral Springs, but there's a lot of things that we expect and that we get a lot more than other communities. So, yeah, maybe we pay a little bit more than we did in the past, but we're trying to get back to where we used to be years ago and keep the high level of service. And one of the things with that tax increase that we heard was, if you guys ever do this again, please just don't do it all at once. Do it gradually over time. And, you know, you talk about cost of you know, living going up for everybody. Well, same thing for the city. When we go ahead and we operate as an organization, every time we buy anything or we do anything, costs go up. You know, healthcare costs from anything like that to even regular purchases. Even when we go out and buy vehicles for fleets, you know, so we're incorporating that also into this. So I know looking at it, you sit there and go, okay, yeah, it's going up, and they're scheduling to go up again. But that's really to make up for the increases moving forward in the cost of doing business. So,
thank you. Anything from you, Commissioner Sarah? Mike?
Yeah, Mayor, thank you. I think the question and the point were great. And so what we're trying to do is show, one, I would say this is stable. I would say this is our stable plan. We're here. It kind of took 3 years to get here of this is what the future looks like. Our residents should, you know, we're looking to be transparent in certainty to where do I like putting out that there's, you know, that I need 15 cents to run the city at the level expected in those out years? I'd prefer not to, but we want to make sure that the public understands that we cannot run the city at the same level of service with less than 3% in our revenues. And so we have things like SROs. You know, the world's changed. Cities now are spending hundreds of thousands of dollars on school resource officers that probably, you know, a decade you didn't. And there's other areas in the country that don't have that. Well, that's something that was unforeseen that it would become such a large. I think we have over 30, you know, how many SROs? 24 SROs. Wow. You know, with so there's things like that, but also one of the things people do not realize is ad valorem taxes is a smaller percentage of the revenue, and a lot of state revenues that we receive are slowing. We were used to, because a lot of them are distributed by population, when we were growing like crazy, times were good, those revenues, well, we're essentially built out. The rest of the county isn't, so every time they're building, that percentage of the revenues is going elsewhere, and so it's actually reducing that amount. So we're looking at long-term, you know, positive financial picture, one that, you know, that we believe that this plan does, and I appreciate the comments. We'll make sure we touch base after this and be able to probably answer them more thoroughly.
Great. Thank you very much. Commissioner?
What I will say I understand your question. Basically, it's like at what, you know, at any point in the future, will there be a rollback or something like that? I would say that would be nice to think about. and maybe that's for the future commission to have to deal with. Maybe something will happen and, you know, a big pallet of cash will just drop into the city, and, you know, budget department will be like, hey, we can look at some different options this time around. But as it stands, you know, before last year with the millage rate increase, the city was facing a very dire financial situation. And this is to make sure that we get into a position where we will never have to face that situation again. And so having this projected outlook and having it where people can actually see potential increases helps everybody plan a little bit better. You know, so I like the track that we're on. I don't want to leave or, you know, be up here and watch the city suffer while I'm here. Everything we're doing, we're trying to be innovative. We have some things in the budget that are going to help bring in, hopefully bring in more dollars into the city so we can kind of stop trying to put things onto the residents' back and things like that. And just we're also being very, very creative with how we bring in dollars to kind of offset some of these costs as well. So we're constantly looking at ways to bring in money without taking it from the residents or any other way like that.
Yeah, so it's one of the reasons that we've invested a little bit more in grant opportunities. We were very fortunate this past year to go up by $4 million from what we've typically had, and that's because of our investment in the new grant person as of 5 years ago. We are listening to you. I think one of the reasons that we have this relatively low fiscal millage rate is because we have so much input from so many great people, not just that work here, but that live here and volunteer for us. We really do incorporate so many ideas from so many people, including City Hall and the Mall. We've got, I think, about $1 million every year in revenue from passports. And that's from one woman's idea many, many years ago. So you're not too late coming here to the budget hearing necessarily to find out answers. We'd love to hear from you during the course of the year. For any of us on this dais, we would love to roll back the rate. We'd love it. But then at what expense? And with what has occurred in our community, unfortunately, we want to invest in the number one public safety operation in the state. And that's what we believe we have. Our police and fire, second to none. We'll put them up against anybody. And the investment that we make in them and that you're making in them by keeping the millage rate the same, we think it's worth it. I was here back from 2002 to 2010. Somehow we were able to reduce millage rates a small amount, but then you look back, and was that the right thing to do back in 2008, 2009? Probably not. Probably not. I was one of the five people that served at that time. So that was probably a part of the decision that Larry had to make and Dan Daly and prior commissioners to make a hard decision. Who wants to hear and talk about a 24% tax increase years ago? Do we love saying, okay, another $62 in property taxes? Do we love hearing from Nina Briscoe and saying this is tough for her? We don't love that. We don't love that. And we do think that we're doing the right thing from hearing from everybody and keeping service levels at a very high level. Coral Springs is a unique, unbelievable, beautiful city to live in, and we are definitely fortunate to live here. And I really appreciate the five-year forecast, the fiscal discipline of our city manager and everybody underneath him and this body. And there's not a reluctance for me to support this millage rate. I am happy to support the millage rate and to continue operating our city at such an excellent level and continue to hear from the residents as we do. Any further discussion? All in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Carries unanimously. Next is Ordinance 2019-124, first reading fiscal year 2020 budget.
This is an ordinance of the City Commission of the City of Coral Springs, Florida, finalizing and adopting the annual operating budget and capital improvement program for fiscal year 2019-2020, reviewed, modified, and approved by the City Commission at meetings held on July 24, 2019, September 12, 2019, and September 18, 2019, which includes the budget for the general fund, water and sewer, fire, solid waste, charter school, stormwater, public art, debt service, health and liability, equipment services, tree trust funds, and capital improvement program funds. Providing the event a variation from the total budget is or becomes necessary, this ordinance shall be amended only by a subsequent ordinance consistent with Chapter 166 Florida statutes, the Charter, and the Code of Ordinances of the City of Coral Springs, Florida, providing for separability, providing for conflict, providing for an effective date. And this is a request to hold a public hearing, approve, and set second reading for September 18th.
This is a public hearing. Would anyone like to be heard? Okay, seeing none, the public hearing is closed. Move to approve.
Second.
Second by Commissioner Sarah. Any discussion? So I'll just share with the public a few of the key initiatives that we have moving forward, and that's grant research enhancement, ADA compliance support. You'll see changes on our website, adds to staff civil engineer, assist the developer for Cornerstone. It's going to be very exciting to see what happens in downtown. Form Village Square Plan with a developer, educational guides, and developing a retail strategy. All of these key initiatives are on page 13 of the budget, of the proposed budget. We welcome you to continue to ask questions of us, of the budget director. On the trim notice, you have the phone number of the budget office, and we'll continue to answer any questions that you have. Any further discussion? Okay, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Carries unanimously. Next is item number 8, resolution 2019-052.
Here first, we have item 8, the public hearing for the increase in sewage
I'm sorry, item 8 is a public hearing for increase. Sorry, I was looking at the old agenda instead of the new one.
Okay, Mayor. So this is number item number 8, which is a request to continue the public hearing from September 12, 2019 at 5:15 p.m. to a date certain of September 18, 2019 at 6:30 p.m.
Need a motion?
Yes.
Moved by Commissioner Vignola. Second by Commissioner Simmons. Any discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Carries unanimously. Next is item number 9, resolution 2019-052, financial policies.
This is a resolution of the City Commission of the City of Coral Springs, Florida, adopting financial policies, providing for an effective date. This is a request to adopt and also to rescind resolution 2011-040, which had articulated the fund balance policy.
Motion to approve with adding a glossary to the financial policy.
Second.
Second to Commissioner Sarah. Any discussion? So I also appreciate one of the financial policies we're putting in place is to allow excess funds to go to our reserve balance, and the reserve balance will be between 17 and 25% as opposed to the 17% that it has been. It shows fiscal conservatism, it shows us being proactive, and a commitment to being stable. Any further discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
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 Carries unanimously. Our next regular meeting is Wednesday, September 18th at 6:30. Thank you all for being here. Have a good evening.